Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship today as we gather together and we know that God and his promise is with us. He's with us today in his body and blood given and shed for the forgiveness of sins. He's with us today in the word that we hear and that we spend time on. He's with us today in his love and in his spirit that we've received in our baptism. I'm glad that you're here with us as well. What a blessing that is. And if you're watching us from home, I'm glad that you're with us as well. Thanks be to God for that. If you would, please, comment below that we might know that you did join us this morning, and we'll celebrate God's love all together. Our order of service, is in your worship folder that you've received. We'll follow that today. As I mentioned, we are celebrating communion today, and today is the third Sunday of the month, and that means during the closing hymn, we'll collect our mission gifts in mites up at the front of the church. And if you would like to give a gift to that, all that money, 100%, goes above and beyond our usual budgeted mission money. So that'll be at the end of the service today. Let's begin our service now. And first, we'll stand up and say good morning to one another. God bless you. Let's begin our service. We'll begin our service in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
So let us then confess our sins to God our Father.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name.
Amen. Hear the promise that God has made to you and to me this day. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You may be seated. We'll continue by joining together and singing our first hymn.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray to the Lord. O Lord, grant us the spirit to hear your word and know the one thing needful, that by your word and spirit we may live according to your will. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We'll continue our service with the reading of God's word in our Bible lessons today.
The first lesson for today is taken from Genesis chapter 18, beginning at the first verse. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre as he sat at the door of his tent in the heat of the day. He lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, three men were standing in front of him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent door to meet them and bowed himself to the earth and said, O Lord, if I have found favor in your sight, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought, and wash your feet, and rest yourselves under the tree, while I bring a morsel of bread, that you may refresh yourselves, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant. So they said, do as you have said. And Abraham went quickly into the tent to Sarah, and said, quick, three seahs of fine flour, knead it, and make cakes. And Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to a young man who prepared it quickly. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, where is Sarah your wife? And he said, she is in the tent. And the Lord said, I will surely return to you about this time next year, and Sarah, your wife, will have a son. And Sarah was listening at the door of the tent behind him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson for today is from Colossians, the first chapter, beginning at the 21st verse. You, who once were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him, if indeed you continue in the faith, stable and steadfast, not shifting from the hope of the gospel that you heard, which has been proclaimed in all creation under heaven, and which I, Paul, became a minister. Now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I am filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, that is, the church, of which I became a minister according to the stewardship from God that was given to me for you, to make the word of God fully known, the mystery hidden for ages and generations, but now revealed to his saints. To them, God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Him we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all wisdom, that we may present everyone mature in Christ. For this I toil, struggling with all his energy, that he powerfully works within me. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the Alleluia verse. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 10. Now as they went on their way, Jesus entered a village, and a woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teaching. But Martha was distracted with much serving, and she went up to him and said, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Tell her then to help me. But the Lord answered her, Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things, but one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the good portion, which will not be taken away from her. This is the word of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated.
And we'll continue by singing our next hymn this morning. God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The Bible passage that's the basis for our message today is the New Testament lesson, St. Paul's letter to the Colossians. I'm going to read the first two verses. You, who once were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he, Jesus, has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him. This is the word of the Lord. You know, there are four words that we hear over and over and over again. You are not perfect. In fact, the advertising companies spend billions of dollars telling you that exact message. You are not perfect. Around the world, companies are making fortunes selling products that are going to make you better. If you have imperfect breath, mouthwash companies will sell you something that makes you kissable. If you have imperfect smile, toothpaste manufacturers will whiten and brighten it over and over again. If you smell less than perfect, there's perfume and cologne to make people not afraid to stand downwind from you. Everything you might need is sold or advertised, at least, to make you a little closer to perfect. Shampoo, will give you the bounce and the gloss and the glimmer that you think you desperately need. And it's not just your appearance either. It's your whole image that we're really talking about. There are cars, there are restaurants, cigarettes, liqueurs, all kinds of things that will turn you into the epitome of young, of modern, of youthful, of being a supermodel. If your future is less than perfect, there are get-rich strategies to pad your account, to give you everything that you want. Books that will give you advice on how to win friends, how to accomplish all that you would have in your life. And once you have everything, once you have the right car, the right deodorant, the right mouthwash, the right counselor, the right reflection, you're still going to feel that you're just not perfect. You're not perfect. I'm not perfect. Our lives are filled with people that are only too happy to remind us about that reality. Starts from when we're young. When you were going to school and you were chosen last to be on a team on the playground, you knew you weren't perfect. When your dad yelled at you or your mom gave you that disappointed look. Somehow dads can't do a disappointed look. Moms do it very well. Then you know that you're not perfect. When you were turned down for a date, when you didn't get the job that you wanted, when you forgot your husband or wife's birthday, when you were passed over for promotion, you remembered that you were not perfect. And Scripture reminds us that we're not perfect either. None of us, not even the best, have been perfect. Noah followed the Lord and built an ark all by himself. And yet, he also drank a little too much. Abraham was a great patriarch, but he was not above telling a lie or two to save his own skin, even at the expense of his wife. God used Moses to bring his people out from slavery in Egypt. But Moses couldn't always resist the temptation to change and take credit for God's orders. David was a mighty warrior, was God's chosen man to lead his people. And yet, he did not stop him from abusing his power. Over and over and over again, the Bible is filled with accounts of heroes of the faith. But they're not heroes because they're perfect. They're heroes because God worked in the midst of their imperfections. You are not perfect. The Bible tells us that. It doesn't pull any punches when it says there's not one single person who has not sinned. Scripture drives that account home. And in our epistle lesson today, the second Bible reading we heard, Paul reminds the Colossians that because of their wicked actions, they, like the rest of people, the rest of all humanity, were originally alienated from God. You heard it. Listen, he says, you who once were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds. You who were not perfect, you who were separated from God and unable to live up to his righteousness, unable to meet his demands and expectations, you were separated, were alienated, were not perfect. And of course, that truth, it's us too. It's us today that Paul is talking to. On our own, we are powerless to do what God would have us to do what God demands. In all the little things in our life, in our homes, in our routines, in our choices, and in our relationships, we show our imperfection. We show that we're not perfect. Have you ever wondered what would happen if Jesus came to your door, your house's door, one night right before dinner? And I wonder about it sometimes. Would I let him in right away? Would I be happy to see him, or would I think, oh, wait a minute, you know, what's going on? What do I have to hide at home? How do I have to clean up what's around me? Would I struggle for words when it came to praying before the meal and if Jesus was at the table with me? Would I hope secretly that maybe he wouldn't stay too long so that I can go back to normal, so that I can go back to my regular life? Might I be just a little bit uncomfortable in his presence because it would shine a light on the fact that I'm not living up to his expectations? See, the worst news is we can't do anything ourselves about our imperfections. We can pick up the houses, but we can't pick up or clean up our hearts. We can curb what we can say, but we can't stop what we think. No matter what, on a spiritual level, since the fall into sin, each one of us is broken. Each one of us is not perfect. And no matter how hard we work at it, no matter how long we try, no matter how hard we struggle, we can't repair our relationship with God. In fact, in a lot of ways, we're like Renault. I was reading a devotion earlier this week, and it talked about Renault. He's a 14th century Belgian duke. Renault ends up being overthrown by his brother who wanted the throne. But it was really a different kind of overthrow. See, Edward, his brother, didn't kill Renault when he took the throne. He didn't even throw him in prison, so to speak. He took him to a castle called Newkirk, and he had a room built around his brother. Now, Renault, well, he enjoyed eating. He enjoyed the good stuff. He was a little larger sized man. And when Edward had the room built, he had it built there with a smaller sized door put in. And he promised Renault, he says, as soon as you come out of this room, I'll return everything to you. I'll return to freedom, a title, power, you'll take over again. Now, it shouldn't have been hard for Renault to come out of that room. None of the windows had bars. The door wasn't locked at all. But Edward, he knew something about his brother. He knew that Renault liked to eat. And every day, Edward sent a variety of delicious foods to Renault. 10 years. And instead of dieting his way out of prison, Renault grew larger and larger and larger as the years passed. Can you see the similarities to our situation there? Like Renault, our original perfect relationship with God has been overthrown by Satan. We've been locked in the prison. We've been kept captive. And like Renault, we might desire our freedom. But like Renault, every day, our sinful desires cause us to do things that keep us in prison. Like Renault, we're not perfect. And by our own powers, it seems we can't change anything. But thank God. Thank God, because Scripture doesn't end with this note, you're not perfect. It also tells us that we don't have to stay alienated from God. Although our sinful nature would condemn us, God, in his mercy, by his grace, saves us. When Adam and Eve were devastated by the knowledge of what they had done, God gave them hope that he would send someone who would crush the devil. When Abraham was without hope of having a home or a family, God promised him hope. He promised him a son, and a country, and a descendant who would be a blessing to all the world. Even though David was a murderer and adulterer, God gave him hope, gave him the promise that one of David's descendants would sit on the throne in a kingdom that would last forever. And when you and I stand up and feel overwhelmed, when we realize that we are not perfect, when we fail to see any way out, God gives us hope as well. His promise is not just for patriarchs. It's not just for kings. It's for you and for me. St. Paul tells us God has, by the blood of the cross, redeemed all creation to himself. He is now reconciled, he writes in our reading today. He is now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him. We were exiled from our home, driven out of the garden, driven out of God's presence. But at the foot of the cross, we found a new home. We were without family, but by God's great grace, we've been adopted into his household. Because of Jesus, we who were poor are now rich. Because of Jesus, we who are hungry have now been fed by the love of God. Because he was stripped, we're dressed and given a robe of righteousness. Because he was forsaken, we have company throughout our life. Because he died, we have life, forgiven and clean. See, God gives us hope. He reminds us that nothing can separate us from the love of God. The blood of the cross is God's message that says, you may not be perfect. You may never make yourself perfect, but God has declared you innocent. But God has made you holy. And now we're called to live holy lives. Not because I tell you to. Not because God is holding a club over your hand, threatening you to, but because he gives you the power, the peace, and the joy to be able to. Oliver Cromwell lived in the 1650s, and he deposed the King of England and took over as ruler and protector of Great Britain. And there's a story that while he was ruling, that there was a shortage of silver in the kingdom. And he sent his men out into the churches to try to find some silver. And they came back and he said, the only thing we can find are the statues of the saints that are in the corners. And at that, Cromwell supposedly replied, great, we'll melt down the saints and we'll put them into circulation. You know what? It's God's plan for you and me. To go into circulation, to not be hiding away in corners, to not keep our faith locked up tight in the dusty corners, but to go out into circulation. In thanksgiving to God, we are empowered to change the world. Because he's brought us into the light by his precious blood, we're able to live as children of light today. So how's your circulation been? We can live as people made perfect by Jesus. Don't underestimate the number of people who see how you live. Don't underestimate the witness that you give, because our Christian life, it's made up of small things, of a multitude of small things that bear witness to Jesus. It's not sermons and books that are written. It's love. It's forgiveness. It's patience. It's kindness. It's understanding. All these actions, not the big miracles, all these actions are a sign of the saints being in circulation. On our own, the challenge is, it's overwhelming. It's bound to leave you feeling that you're not perfect. But in Christ, by his grace, through his mercy, and with his strength, we are able to live, well, as saints, as holy people, as children of God. We've been perfected by the blood of the Lamb. We've been made holy by the Son of God who lives in us so that we might live as the redeemed children of God. And he sends us out into the world. He sends us out into circulation so that we can share that love with those who are around us as God's saints. So the next time you hear, the next time you feel you're not perfect, we can thank God. Because God is the one who has perfected us by his life, death, and resurrection. And God is the one who gives us his grace as we journey and live for his glory. out in circulation every day of our lives. Amen. And may the peace of Christ that passes all understanding keep your hearts and minds in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen. Having heard God's word, we respond by confessing our faith according to the words of the Nicene Creed. If you're able, would you stand and join with me in this?
We confess. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of God and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We'll continue our service by bringing our prayers and requests to God, even as he has invited us to. In your worship folder, you have our prayer list inserted so that you can pull this out and take it home and keep these needs in your prayers this coming week. I have one addition to the list. We pray for the family of Peggy Harper. Peggy is the sister-in-law of Gene Steinberg, who passed away this week. Let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, and for all people according to their needs. O Father in heaven, we confess to you today the reality that we are not perfect. We are powerless to do what you demand, and it shows up clearly in all areas in our life. It shows up in our homes and our routines and our choices and more. Above all, it shows up in our relationship with you. We are not perfect, and we are helpless to change that reality. Lord, in your mercy, we thank you, though, that although our sinful nature condemns us, you sent your Son, Jesus, to save us. Your promise is not just for patriarchs and kings, but for us. St. Paul says that you, by the blood of the cross, have reconciled all creation to himself, and now, renewed by your goodness in Jesus, put us, like the statues of the saints, out in circulation, serving, forgiving, loving, and sharing with others the good news of your love. On our own, the challenge would be overwhelming, but you send us out and give us the power to live as your holy people. Send us into the world, into circulation, as your saints, and give us grace as we journey and live to your glory. Lord, in your mercy, O God of love, deliver the sick from their illnesses, give relief to the suffering, help the troubled to know peace of mind, and be with those grieving and in their final days. Give patience to those who must bear with their infirmities and disabilities. Hear us especially, we pray, Jesus, for Kathy and Brian, Bill, Michael, Ron, and Danielle, Ray and Amber, Andrew and Latonya, Matt, Ron, Dave, Richard, and Fred. Hear us for Becky and Carol, Al and Kristen, Gordon, Jen, Alice, and Scott, for Amy and Pat,
for Betty and Jim, for Cece and Lance, and for all those that we name before you in our own hearts and minds. Dear Lord, we know their needs, their worries, their fears. We ask that you would be with them. If it be your will, grant them health and healing, strength and recovery, that they might feel better and be out again. But most of all, remind them of your presence, assure them of your love, and give them the confidence to know they are never alone or forgotten. Lord, in your mercy, Heavenly Father and God of all concord, it is your gracious will that your children on earth live together in harmony and peace. Defeat the plans of those who would stir up violence and strife. Destroy the weapons of those who delight in war and bloodshed. And according to your will, end all violence and conflicts in the world. We pray for the people suffering from violence in Illinois and across our land. And we also pray for the people of Ukraine who are experiencing military aggression, that they may be kept from harm. And we pray for the Evangelical Lutheran Church of Ukraine, that their pastors and people might find rest and comfort in the promise that you have given to them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, Father of all mercies and giver of all comfort, deal graciously with all those who mourn, including the family of Renee, the family of Richard, the family of Clarice, and the family of Peggy, as well as those that we named before you today as well. Pour out your spirit upon them. When all things seem out of control, remind them that you are still in control and that your love and care continue in their life until the day when they, having received the promises that you have fulfilled in the lives of those they love, may stand before you, rejoining their loved ones in your presence eternally, so that they, casting every care on you, may know the consolation of your love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear
us, O Lord, and give answer to the prayers of your people, prayed in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, whom with the Father and the Spirit you are one God and one Lord forevermore. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
You may be seated.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death in the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and to be our Savior.
With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. So gather, in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood, as he bids us to do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth, to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. For to you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. This do in remembrance of me." The same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood shed for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. And the peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. To life everlasting. Amen. Depart in peace and with Easter joy. Amen.
Take and eat. This is the true life of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, given and shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. And now, may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you in body and soul unto you. Go in peace.
Thank you.
of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed for you. And may this, the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed for the forgiveness of all your sins, may this strengthen and preserve you in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen. Depart in peace and with Easter joy. Amen. May you drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Take a drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Take a drink. Strengthen and preserve you in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen. To depart in peace and with Easter joy. Amen. blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed for the forgiveness of all your sins. And may this body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen. Depart in peace and with Easter joy. Amen. Let us pray to the Lord.
We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
And receive the blessing of the Lord. Lord bless you and keep you. Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. Let's close by singing our final hymn. Glad that you joined us today. What a blessing it is to be together again. And that includes you who joined us online. I'm glad that you were with us today. May God continue to work in your life his good and perfect will, even as he has promised. Couple of announcements or things before I let you go. First of all, of course, we celebrate with those who are celebrating today, or this week, I should say. It's Laura's birthday, Catherine Noble's birthday, and Jay and Cindy are here. It's their anniversary week this week. Let's congratulate them. I want to thank the Fabulous Five who led us off in song today. What a blessing it is to have them again. Thank you very much. Bible studies this week continue as usual. Tuesday morning, the women's Bible study meets together in the choir room, and that's at 10 o'clock. Wednesday, we meet online at Zoom, and that's at 10:30. And then next Sunday morning, we're continuing a Bible study on prayer, and that'll meet here in person in the sanctuary at 9, and it's also live streamed on Facebook at 9 as well. Operation Christmas Child, you know, we don't get weary of doing good. God gives us the strength to do that. There's an insert. The board out in the back shows you some items from previous months that have not yet been filled. Our goal is to build 150 shoeboxes. Remember, these are not just presents, but they go with the message of God's love and care to kids around the world. And so join us in that. Little Free Pantry, everybody, it seems, from here who volunteers a week comes back and says, it always seems to be low. And that's because people are using it. Praise God that people are finding what they need in it. So we also are relying upon you. Remember the Little Free Pantry when you go grocery shopping. Last I heard, they needed everything with the exception of macaroni and cheese. We were blessed with a couple of large boxes of that, but we could still use some help on it. I think ramen we needed, didn't you say?
Pasta.
We need other pasta besides macaroni and cheese. Okay, on the blue table, our signups for volunteer things. Remember, we need help with cameras. There's Coffee Fellowship out there. We talked a little bit about that last Sunday. Ushers, altar people. But there's also something that's been new the past few weeks. It's our dinner club. This fall, we're looking at meeting together in groups and having dinner together. And there'd be three times during the course of the year. If you want more information, it's in your bulletin, or maybe it was in the Thursday email. Sign up if you want to be a part of that on the blue table out in the narthex. Okay? That's all that I have right now. God bless you for being here. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.